Today, OpenAI released GPT-5.2. This is their final end-of-year salvo back at Google's Gemini 3 Pro and Anthropic's Claude Opus 4.5 to refute the notion that these competitors have snatched the lead. Over the past few weeks, the narrative has really shifted against OpenAI as Google released Gemini 3 Pro. And personally, I find that this loss to Gemini 3 has been a long time coming. Since earlier this year, after the release of Gemini 2.5 Pro and Claude 3.7, I found OpenAI models to be a bit of a jack-of-all-trades, master-of-none proposition. At each downstream task, there was a model that could beat OpenAI's offering. For example, in the domain of coding, it would be Claude 3.7, and maybe in long context or multimodality, it would be Gemini 2.5 Pro. However, because OpenAI was still right on the frontier in every subtask, combined with their consumer mindshare and distribution advantage with ChatGPT, they were able to maintain their dominance. The same is not true for the enterprise API market. We've seen their dominance slip here massively over the past year. For the specialized workflows and agents that enterprises are trying to build, there's often a better model that is better specialized for that particular area. And here we've seen OpenAI lose ground massively to competitors. However, Gemini 3 Pro marked a tipping point for the consumer market as well. It was the first model to beat OpenAI on nearly every task simultaneously. At that point, the good enough overall strategy no longer worked. They're losing the specialized enterprise tasks to Anthropic, and they're losing the general model consumer tasks to Gemini. So that brings us to GPT 5.2. What OpenAI needs to do here is they need to prove they're capable of creating a strong generalist model that leads in every downstream task possible. Not being second, they have to claim the crown. They also need to prove that they're able to consistently stay ahead of Anthropic and especially Google. Since Google is an incumbent with massive resources and infrastructure, if OpenAI cannot beat them in terms of the model prowess, Google will be the de facto winner because of their financing and infrastructure. All right, so let's jump into the GPT 5.2 models. Looking at the blog post here, unlike GPT 5.1, GPT 5.2 is a very work-oriented release. And immediately in the first paragraph of the blog post, we can see them stating that GPT 5.2 is their most capable model series yet for professional knowledge work. And personally, I think that they have realized although users on the free tier have complained that they like GPT-4o better because those sometimes have better personalities and writing styles, OpenAI has realized those users aren't paying. So they really need to orient towards professional users using ChatGPT and the enterprises using their products through the API to build agents and workflows. And so that brings us to the objective of unlocking more economic value. Things like creating better spreadsheets, building better presentations, writing better code, perceiving images on long context and reasoning through them for tasks, and very importantly, using tools. So tying into this, if we scroll down, we can see the headlining evaluation for this model is GDP Val, where they have taken back the lead by doubling their previous score. And what this number means is that, judged by an expert panel, in 70.9% of cases, GPT 5.2 can beat industry experts in creating these outputs for all sorts of different industries in knowledge work. Now again, OpenAI here is comparing to their own last generation models, and we haven't gotten scores for Claude Opus 4.5 or Gemini 3 Pro. And to further hit home the idea that GPT 5.2 is a job killer, OpenAI displays all these different artifacts from different tasks, like spreadsheets for financial data, hiring plans and budgets, or complex presentations and slides. One of the particular fields that we see OpenAI has focused on here is software engineering. And recently, we have seen mass adoption of these coding agents in software development. And this is where we also see that Claude has largely taken the lead. Here we see that on SWE Bench Pro, GPT 5.2 Thinking is able to achieve a brand new state-of-the-art score of 56%. This beats Claude Opus 4.5's previous state-of-the-art score, which was 52% without thinking. That being said, I'm not sure if this is a win for OpenAI. if we turn the reasoning effort of GPT-5.2 to a more reasonable 20k tokens, which is the medium thinking level, we can see that it actually loses to Claude Opus 4.5 without thinking, which without the long chain of thought will actually likely be a cheaper model to use. So although OpenAI has been able to claim the crown on this benchmark, usability-wise, I find that Claude might still win out. Beyond these headlining benchmarks, we see OpenAI evaluating the specific skills and fundamental capabilities of the model. The first is factuality. This is likely the first jump OpenAI has seen since o1, and this model is making around 30% less mistakes. Lowering hallucination rates is key to agentic workflows, because if you cannot trust the outputs and need a human to manually examine them, you cannot take the human out of the loop, limiting a lot of the opportunities for automation and acceleration. Next, we are seeing the huge improvements that GPT-5.2 thinking has made on long context. In the MRCR 2.0 with four needles, GPT-5.2 thinking is able to achieve a huge lead over previous models. In particular, at 256k context, OpenAI's GPT-5.2 thinking is able to achieve up to 2x the retrieval accuracy of Gemini 3. And we don't really see the performance degrading over long context. So although Gemini 3 Pro still has a longer total context length of 1 million tokens, it is completely possible that with its 400k token context, OpenAI's GPT-5.2 actually has a higher usable or effective long context ability. In the visual reasoning section, we also see that this model is doing extremely well. Particular professional use cases are evaluated here, including reading charts, technical diagrams, and visual reports. In this ChartKive reasoning benchmark, we see that OpenAI has claimed a new state-of-the-art with a score of 88.7%. On ScreenSpot Pro, which is GUI screenshot understanding, the model is again scoring a new state-of-the-art. And this is a very good sign for building these computer use agents where models need to be able to diagnose the issues it's running into, create a new plan, and go back to execute. Right now, a lot of these computer use agents get stuck in loops, so if it's able to reason better about these screenshots, it should be able to exit these loops much better than prior models. Next, we see that on tool calling, the model has major leaps. On Taobench Telecom, we see that GPT-5.2 has been able to beat out Claude Opus, and for Taobench Retail, GPT-5.2 has come very, very close. Finally, we move into scientific and STEM reasoning. And this is a domain that really has taken a backseat to enterprise use and consumer products over the past 6 months. We see that on the massively saturated GPQA diamond, GPT-5.2 thinking achieves similar results to Gemini 3 DeepThink. That being said, because these benchmarks generally have around 5% of incorrect answers in them, if a model scores this close to 95%, it starts to become a bit random, so the usefulness of this benchmark is now questionable. On Frontier Math, we can see this model delivers OpenAI's first real significant jump since o3 1 year ago. From GPT-5.1 thinking, it jumped another 10% to this 40.3%. We're also seeing really strong performance on ArcAGI2, where the model is scoring a new state-of-the-art of 52.9%. In addition to these official evaluations from OpenAI, I also ran two of my own benchmarks. In Gatebench, a benchmark for VLMs used to test visual reasoning and image understanding, GPT-5.2 scored 43.8%, which is the best of any GPT model ever. However, this is still roughly 10% under Gemini 3 Pro, and that's even on the extra high reasoning effort level. On SVG Bench, however, where models are prompted to create all sorts of different physical objects using SVGs, GPT-5.2 on the extra high reasoning effort scored a brand new state-of-the-art of 74.4%. Now, let's check out the model cards. OpenAI has released three models as part of the GPT-5.2 series. This includes GPT-5.2 Chat, GPT-5.2 Thinking, and GPT-5.2 Pro. As usual, GPT-5.2 Chat is the non-thinking model, which will be the most useful for low latency use cases like chat. GPT-5.2 is likely the model that will see the most use throughout the API for use cases like agents, etc. And GPT-5.2 Pro is the most maximally buffed version of GPT-5.2, which really should just be used for the most complex reasoning tasks. If we dive into the model card here for GPT-5.2, we immediately notice the new higher price and the updated knowledge cutoff. We can see that for GPT-5.2, the pricing has been bumped to $1.75 per million input tokens and $14 per million output tokens. Personally, I find that the price to performance of GPT-5.2 is pretty good, given that its main competitors are Gemini 3 Pro and Claude Sonnet 4.5. And what this tells us immediately is that GPT-5.2 has likely been pre-trained from scratch. And because of the increased pricing, this is likely a bigger model than GPT-5. And people have really been asking for a brand new pre-trained model from OpenAI since GPT-4.0, which was released a year and a half ago. And we now see that GPT-5.2 has the most recent knowledge cutoff of any major model that's out there. OpenAI also said on their blog post that their model was trained on Microsoft Azure data centers using the H100, H200, and the brand new GB200 NVL72 Blackwell systems, which I believe is the first major model to do so. So having analyzed the benchmarks, the pricing, and the real-world capabilities of this model, we need to circle back to the rubric we set out at the beginning. Is GPT-5.2 good enough? Is it the new best generalist model? Unfortunately, I would have to say no. Despite all the improvements that the model has clearly made in terms of long context, hallucination, knowledge cutoff, etc., I do not think it is good enough. In particular, we see that the model struggles to edge out Claude Opus 4.5 and Gemini 3 Pro at downstream tasks without exploding the amount of output tokens by using a long chain of thought. So although this model is king at so many of these benchmarks, I think in practical use, it will often be neck and neck with the other offerings like Claude and Gemini. And just as disappointing to me is that by neglecting to release a GPT-5.2 mini, they have pretty much ceded the high-volume, low-latency market to Gemini Flash or Grok Fast. So overall, I'd say GPT-5.2 is a very solid upgrade and will likely help them defend the market share of ChatGPT in the consumer space, but will not be good enough to take back market share in the enterprise market.